Chapter 9, Part 1, Internet Law, Social Media, and Privacy. This is a short chapter because this is a really kind of unique thing to talk about as a special area of law. Really, it's not traditionally a special area of law, but there are so many things growing out of the Internet and the electronic world that the authors made it a special chapter. Okay, so the first thing to talk about is what is internet law? Courts are often in uncharted waters when deciding disputes that involve the internet, social media, and online privacy. The obvious reason for that is that all these things are new, and as a result of that, they're creating new issues that the courts have to decide. We talked about that before because one of the biggest issues initially was what's a signature on an electronic contract. Okay, so all these things are coming up with regard to the internet. Unsolicited spam is unsolicited junk emails with ad solicitations and other messages. I should say that you guys probably know most of this stuff better than I do because you're a generation that has grown accustomed to both the internet and computers and smartphones, and to some extent smartphones are replacing computers. To some degree, if not completely for some people. So 37 states have legislation requiring an opt-out of further email ads. So what you may see at the end of your email is the thing where it offers you the opportunity to opt out so you don't keep getting this spam. Okay, the Federal CAN-SPAM Act permits the sending of unsolicited commercial email but prohibits certain types of spamming activities. The prohibited activities include the use of a false return address and the use of a false, misleading, or deceptive information when sending emails. Botnets are automatic spamming networks. The U.S. Safe Web Act allows the Federal Trade Commission to cooperate and share information with foreign agencies that investigate and prosecute cybercrimes. It also provides ISPs with immunity from liability for supplying information to the FTC. Okay, domain names. We talked about this before. You know what a domain name is. That's basically an address where a person's web page can be found. It has two levels. So here you see the Cengage, which is the publisher of your textbook, and their domain name. The Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, ICANN, is where you get your address from. It's not very expensive. I think it's like $50. Okay. Cyber squatting, we already talked about. Cyber squatting is where somebody tries to buy a domain name of a famous company or person in order to exclude that person from being able to get it because it would be obvious advertising and access for people who want to get to that domain name. And then they hold it hostage to that corporation or that entity in order to extract large sums of money to sell that domain name. So Congress has made that illegal under these circumstances. Okay. However, some cyber squatting continues. Based upon the fact that things change so quickly and it's difficult to track mass operating systems. Okay, typo cyber squatting is the registration of a name that is a misspelling of a popular brand. So instead of buying Google, you would buy G-O-O-G-L, a misspelling of Google. That would mislead the public and get a lot of hits, which generates increased profits for those advertisers, but deters or takes people away from the actual web page that they're looking for, a domain that they're looking for. Applicability and sanctions of the ACPA, it applies to all domain registrations of trademarks. And successful plaintiffs can collect damages, profits, and statutory damages. Okay, meta tags, These are keywords that give the internet browser specific information about a web page and increase the likelihood that a site will be included in a search, in a search research. Knowing that if you have a product or a service that you're trying to sell, what do you want when somebody does a search, whether it be through Google or one of the other Explorer, or one of the other search mechanisms. You want to be one of the first ones, if not the first one, to come up on the list, because people are going to click usually in that order, and if they find something they like, they may not go further. So you want those meta tags that are going to give you that up on the others. Trademark dilution in the online world occurs when a trademark is used without authorization in a way that diminishes the distinctive quality of the product. It doesn't require that the consumer be confused, and doesn't mean that the products have to The products don't have to be similar as long as it creates the confusion. Okay, so copyright law with regard to the digital world. Very important form of intellectual property protection. Much of the material that you'll find on the internet is copyrighted. In order to transfer that material online, it has to be copied, and that may cause infringement and a violation, so you need to be aware of that both as a user and also as an owner of that copyrighted material. Much easier to appropriate, or I should say misappropriate, that material from online usage. Keep in mind the fair use exception that we talked about earlier with regard to copyright law. The Digital Millennium Copyright Act provides civil and criminal penalties to circumvent encryption software. It limits ISP liability for subscriber acts, but also allows for fair use exceptions like libraries, universities, and others. The liability of the internet service, service providers and an ISP is not liable for copyright infringement by its customers unless it is aware of the subscriber's violation. So that's one way of curing a violation of a copyright infringement, is to contact the internet service provider and inform them that somebody has lifted that information. Okay, file sharing. Software created by programs to compress large data files, particularly those associated with music. So as you may know, although you guys are young, so you were babies, or young toddlers probably when a lot of this started, but when the digital world started to exist, at that time, I guess the popular method for selling and buying music was CDs. Before that, it had been tapes. So when the digital world came into play, we were able to download music in a digital format, either from a CD or from online. And that, of course, did a couple of things. But the main thing it did was made it very easy to breach copyright laws by simply downloading from some source where you're not paying, or you're paying a price way below what would be the market price. Sometimes through peer-to-peer networking, individuals on the same network access files stored in another's computer, cloud computing. So now we have available where you can buy over the internet, and you can do it through cloud, etc. Okay. So as we said, there's a lot of pirating, not only of music, but also of movies and television. So when you do that, you are taking away substantial amounts of royalties and revenues from the artists or the developers of that intellectual property that has been copyrighted, and results in a lot of lost revenue. And it's not just the lost revenue, because as we talked about earlier, one of the reasons behind this is to encourage people to be inventive and to be creative. And this takes away some of the incentive to do that. Okay, I'm going to stop there for concern about maybe not having enough space, and we'll pick up after in the next video.